Hi everyone and welcome to Cherry Red TV. In a career spanning nearly 40 years, John Wardle, aka Jar Wobble, has been one of the most prolific and diverse artists to have graced a musical stage. His next release is a box set called Redux, which looks back across his career. He joins us today to discuss his life and work. Welcome, John.
Hello, Matt.
So, to begin with, can you tell us a bit about your early life and in particular when music sort of became a big part of it?
Oh, earliest musical memories are tied in with religion, I suppose. I'd hear mass sung in Latin. I can remember that. My dad was a big classical music fan, so he'd listen to Beethoven very loud. He was been a veteran in the eighth. He was an Eighth Army veteran. He'd been at El Alamein. Tinnitus ears, probably because of the guns fire. I don't think they wore ear muffs in those days. I don't think health and safety was that kind of big in the 40s. So he listened to Beethoven quite loud in the kitchen. All the family's basically got Irish ancestry going back a lot of years. It was not at all plastic paddy stuff, don't worry about that. But me mum used to play the Dubliners a lot.
Okay.
And so I did the Dubliners, Irish folk, and I loved the Dubliners. And so that was kind of a funny kind of mix. My mum used to buy me every Friday at Whitechapel Waste, which was the market. She'd buy me a record from Paul's record store. Paul also had a record store in Cambridge Heath Road around the corner, which was actually had all the Blue Beat chart would be up on the wall there, up basically Scar. Okay. At that time, that was the urban music of the time. So I started hearing lots of reggae. Basically, to me, it's reggae music very early on. My mum would buy me a single. My first single I ever got was Jim Reeves' Welcome to My World.
It's a good start.
and the second one was Bel Ives' Froggy Goes A-Courting. And I would obsessively play those tunes. And I would apparently obsessively hum tunes. You know, there was one tune that was off of a kid's children's thing. I used to hum over and over and over again. It was a sort of animal show. But those were the first. So that was the first musical sort of thing. And I can remember as well, at that time, in the East End, all the Catholic parishes would have a march, a procession. Really, it wasn't a march. It was a procession, and they'd have statues of Our Lady up. And I think the Italians. Parish Saffron Hill in Clerkenwell would have they would do the procession. I think they still do. I think all the other parishes, I think they stopped it a long time ago. But every parish had its own drum and fife band.
Okay.
And apparently my forebears were particularly good drummers.
Okay.
So I think all that, which kind of matches with a lot of.
Yeah.
It's quite could be quite Moroccan.
So the rhythm was natural.
So maybe there's some DNA thing in there, I don't know. But when I went on to play with Moroccan musicians, the rhythms never threw me for a second. So, you know, maybe there's. That's a kind of rough potpourri of, you know, so. And even you could consider Plain Song, you know, that you know, some of that Catholic stuff you'd hear in the churches is quite medieval, quite early, very early kind of music. So it was a real potpourri. That and of course my dad in the kitchen with the blazing music of the Age of Enlightenment, going, you know, da 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 da, which I quite like myself. I'm not against a bit of Beethoven. Oh, the Seventh is my favourite. It's quite stately, you know.
And your sister was quite into Trojan as well, wasn't she?
Yeah, she was a big Trojan fan. It was the kind of urban hip music of its time, so it was very popular. People, as you know, people say if the chart return system had been a bit fairer, possibly, there would have been even more commercial success for reggae music and ska music over the years, even more than it had. It was kind of, people feel it was kept kind of a bit suppressed, possibly, with the way the chart system kind of worked, you know. But yeah, it was something I loved that stuff. And once I'd heard reggae, I stayed with it. The ska boom kind of died away by about 71, 72, but I stayed with it. And I'd listen to a show on Radio London, lunchtime on a Sunday. I'd religiously listen to that. And it had a couple of Caribbean dudes on there playing reggae music or the odd calypso track as well, because I think that's a cater for other West Indians other than Jamaicans. And I'd listen to that, and I used to listen to that every week. I'd listen to that, and I loved the instrumentals. I always liked instrumental music a lot as well. So there was quite a big potpourri, interesting potpourri of stuff. Yeah. You know, as I moved into teenage years, as I got into, you know, 12s and 13s, I loved the Faces. So I loved Mandolin, so, and Lindisfarne. I naturally leant towards this kind of modal, folky kind of style.
Yeah.
The Tamla Motown was the big popular music of the day, and obviously I loved that. But the sound of Philly with the strings and the congas high up in the mix with the OJs and stuff, that was my music. I loved that. You know, that was the stuff I really as I become old. And Stevie Wonder, of course. Inner Visions is still in my top 10 albums of all time. I love that album.
So after you left school, you went to Kingsway College.
Yeah, I got expelled from school.
Okay.
And ended up at Kingsway.
And you met quite a few people there that were to play quite a big role in the next few years of your life.
Brought up in the East End. Had a very definite kind of culture. It wasn't at all gentrified at all. And then when I went to Kingsway, it was North London, Islington, King's Cross. It was very, very sort of run down. Looking back now, incredibly kind of run down. And I met John Lydner, of course, who became Johnny Rotten and the Sex Pistols, and Sid as well, you know, came. And
Sid Vicious.
Yeah. Sid Vicious. It was John that introduced me to my first sort of going to, you know, kind of concerts, probably, at that time. And I went to the Roundhouse, and I was into just this hippie culture and all the squats. It was very, very Withnell and I, the scene. And I loved it because this was a big, huge adventure for me. You're in another part of London, you know, miles away from where you come from, and it was a real adventure being in North. It was a completely different vibe. It was all these hippies. I remember John going past this hippie-looking bloke, and he went, "Oh, Arthur, you're all right." And I was like, "It's Arthur Brown." You know, the crazy world of Arthur. We had the fire.
Yeah.
And I was like, "It's Arthur Brown." He said, "He's my mate."
So it was a really interesting...
And John was like two, three years older than me, which is a big difference then, and really took me under his wing, really. You know, I was just this tearaway kid. I might be put down as ADHD kind of afflicted now or something. I was certainly a nuisance.
Right.
Very lively mind. This, that and the other, and so that was the making of me really going to Kingsbury. You end up in the right place at the right time. That's what it's all about.
And Sid actually gave you your stage name inadvertently one day.
It was years later. I didn't get called Joe Wobble until I was probably 18, just as I was in Peel, actually, I think. And I can remember the night we were trying to get, I don't know where we were, squat. And it was a locked door. We had the key to the door. We were so drunk that we couldn't. And Sid, I never really think of Sid as a drinker, but apparently people, you know, Viv Albertine was saying, no, he was always being a brown ale, which I just thought Sid was more into drugs, you know. But we were both really drunk and trying to get through this door. And it was really, you know, when you're the classic cliche drunk. You know, you're trying to
can't
really, it's like you're
lock.
Doing precision surgery, keyhole surgery or something, rather than just putting a key in a keyhole. And we stopped and sort of had a fag and took a break before having another crack at this. And he said, "You know what, I'm going to call you Joe Wobble because John Wardle, because you like reggae and I can't say your name." And I said, "I'm going to keep that because people will remember that." Because I think it was because I was just starting to think, oh, I'm going to be in a band, or I was about to be in a group or something like that, and that's how it come about.
And in I guess around sort of 76, 77, after the two Johns had gone off to make their way with the Pistols, you kind of started your own musical journey and you picked up the bass. And I think a lot of bass players tend to be kind of frustrated guitarists, but that was never the case with you.
I always joke I've got big navvies hands. They're quite sensitive as a pianist, a classical pianist, but they're big old hands, and all this C major, E2, you know, it's too, oh my God, you know. And I've actually gone on to play a bit of mandolin, believe it or not, which is really like a narrow neck, you know. But I just love bass. I went off in July 75, and I love bass anyway. On the reggae records, I was always drawn to the B-lines very early on, because that you heard a little bit more bass on ska records than you did on most rock, genuine sort of bass frequencies. And I went to see Bob Marley and the Wailers at the Lyceum. I mean, it was the I3s, actually, as I recall. But at Family Man, Barrett on bass, who's one of my favourite bass players, because he's got a fantastic musical phrasing, you know. And I mean, that I think completely sold me, because it was the best sound I ever heard at the Lyceum, which was a fiddly gig actually to get a good sound, but it was a really good sound and a really good bottom end. And there was this guy, you know, it's like you've got the power of the universe being transmuted through you with that heavy, you know, it's incredible, this, you know, the power that you get. And I was always just, no, I just want to play bass. And it's a very specific choice. It's maybe not specific personality-wise as drummers, who tend to be a bit bonkers, and they're the goalkeepers of the music world. You know, drummers, yeah. God bless them. You know, they're musicians, but they're not, in a way. you know. And I'm definitely a bassist. It's written, you know, I was just never a guitarist. I play a bit of drums, funny enough, you know, and some percussion, but bass was very, very much my instrument. You know, it's a fantastic instrument. When you get into the theory of subharmonics, it's a fascinating area where music becomes, I like it with music and with life, where essentially it's kind of empty. There probably isn't any smallest particle. And music becomes some kind of waveform. It's this beautiful, actually, in essence, some sort of emanation of everything we're not, which is probably love or something. So I'm getting a bit profound, so I better shut up. But that's kind of when you basically you lose yourself. So yeah. Because I was probably a bit ADHD, or a little a bit of an anxious, nervy, hyper kind of person, when I played bass as well, I wanted to play the same lines. I wanted to play quite repetitively. Yeah. And I'm a groove player, really. And when I play,
you're away.
It's cool. Everything's yeah. Nice. I'll just play, you know. So I might not play for weeks on end, but then if the bass is there, I just pick it up and I'll just sit there. There'll always be something, some evolving line that will come every time. It happened yesterday when at a gig, you know, warming up, something happens, and the best bit of playing, which is often the case yesterday with my band, was before the show.
Yeah.
That was the most genuine bit of playing with six or seven people in the room as we're setting up, you know.
Yeah. And then early 78, the Pistols kind of imploded, and I think not too long after that, you got a call from John asking you to join a band he was putting together with Keith Levine on guitar, which became Pill. What was it like to get that call for someone that, you know, I don't think you'd ever played any gigs, you'd never played with a band at that point, is that right?
Yeah, but what I'd done, I could have done, but I didn't. And I wasn't interested in playing three-chord thrash rock and roll. And in a way, the whole ethos of punk, and certainly post-punk for me, in essence, was kind of, it had the essence of the abstract expressionists a little bit, especially like America, you know, Pollocks of this world and stuff. And they say, in the theory of art, that music is normally about 30 years behind visual arts.
Okay.
You know, with artistic, so impressionist music come 30 years after Monet and all that were getting going or whatever, you know. And I kind of found, so he's got this movement with punk. This really means it's very expressive, you know. It's very expressive, but actually the music is really conservative, and it's like poor Buddy Holly or something in essence for me, you know. And I just absolutely wasn't interested. There's always an exception. The exception was like the Buzzcocks, boredom, and the lyrics. It was great. It was really tight, and it was really. They just had something, and that was fine. Or yeah. New Rose, The Damned, was a tune I liked. But overall, I just wasn't interested in it. It was very one-dimensional. And I had a bass, and I'd sold the amp and the lead for beer money. And I'd ended up in a squat And I had the headboard, but not the rest of the bed, just the headboard. And I'd lean the bass against the headboard. And it was a Music Man copy. The action was ridiculously high, so it was really difficult. But I got sound. And I started to, and we'll talk about it later, I suppose, you know, but I started to, you know, when I get the bass out, but I started to I didn't have any musical training. I looked at the frets with all the dots on the fret, and I played not scales really, but modes, and I played in patterns. In essence, actually, it was the way music was probably made in the medieval period and was still kind of made in lots of musics around the world. It's kind of pre-bark, pre-tonality. And you've got strong essence of that in Peel. Even with the single, Public Image, it's quite a modal, it's a bass line, it's not particularly tuneful. Levine plays guitar on it. It's actually really clever pop kind of part. And it's a real pop. Right from the word go with Peel, even before we went into the primal scream, if you like, of Metal Box, there was this kind of quite modal, sort of tonal kind of element to it, you know.
So what was the dynamic?
So that's what I was thinking of, you know. I was very excited. It was a funny day because I felt, I kind of was a bit OCD-ish, you know. So I'm layering every mental condition under the sun on myself. But I was more OCD-ish than anything else, actually. Very obsessive sort of, you know. And I'd have these obsessive, when I walked from my house to Whitechapel, I had to go exactly the same way, the exact same amount of steps and all that. It's, you know, classic stuff. And that day when I come back from Whitechapel, I went in a anti-clockwise direction around the small library on the middle of the estate. It's bonkers, but it's, you ask it, I'm showing you my world. And so I did this weird thing of going, for me, an OCD dude, going against the grain. And I got in and I just thought, something's weird going on today. I've just gone this different way around and the library. And I got a phone call from John. Yeah, I'm forming this, I'm going to put a new band together. And I want you and Keith to be. He was like, oh, do you want to come over? I'm like, it was very exciting. And all I remember being excited wasn't, I'm going to be in a band and travel the world. It was like, I've got all these ideas.
Yeah.
And the ideas were like, there were bass lines, but I was starting to formulate ideas of, say you put a bass line like this with this kind of a sound, and you know,
you're putting the fragments of a song
kind of electronic and textury, just very early days in a very ham-fisted but genuine way. And I think what denotes real art is probably intention. It's a vague area. It's like, how can you prove somebody's intention's valid or not? But you know, that's why talking to someone like Pollock, you know, he did this random paint thing. Why do we believe him more than somebody else? Because he really meant it. You know, I think he really, really just naturally expressed himself. It wasn't a juvenile, I'm going to throw paint on the wall. It was a genuine expression of randomness, you know. You know, there was a random quality, there's a vividness. It's trying to capture the vividity, the vividness and the randomness of life, the beauty of out of chaos comes some kind of order.
Yeah.
And we always are able to kind of impose our own cosmology on randomness, if you like, and see a picture in chaos or something, you know. And whatever, you know, and there was a real intention there, you know. So I was very, very lucky. I was very, very lucky to be somebody who had no musical training to suddenly be in this position, you know. And it was fantastic. And I've slagged John and Keith off, obviously, to high heaven at times, you know. Terrible people. Ugh, I was in a band with the worst people. But, you know, in essence, it was. I'm also very, very grateful for that situation, because I was able. Nobody ever said, "Oh, right, this one, start. Yeah, we've written this song." And this, it was. I just did what I wanted.
Okay.
So I was able to bring these bass lines. It was very, very simple basis to Peel. You know, it always started with a bass line. It never started with a guitar riff. It always started with a bass line.
And as you say, Public Image, pretty much the first song that you ever, I think, did at rehearsals.
It was I always say it was the first ever bass line. It was probably the second or third, actually, which I've never admitted before. but it was the most happening one. It was one of the very first bass lines I ever come up with. And as I would say, it got to number 10. It was the highest commercial success I've ever had, been involved in, and it's been a steady decline since. It's been a very, very gentle decline, you know.
So you, off the back of that, you did the first album, First Edition.
Yeah.
Which, I guess it's probably not what most Sex Pistols fans were thinking was going
to
be John's next
move. I think they were
move.
Very happy with the single. That was like, wow, everyone went crazy for it because it was very commercial. And then when they heard the rest of the album and you started to have some far out tracks like Annalisa, which is to me isn't that far out. It's a really dark groove. Yeah. You know, it's like, and it's a mutant Tamla beat. Do da da and bat and bat and da 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 da. It's Tamla.
Yeah.
It's the Supremes or something, you know, kind of backbeat, you know. But people read it as really horrible. So the album got, and of course, Fodderstomp, which now people love it. You know, they think it's great. And there's a really good. There was a Belgian band who got me to play it on stage, one of these dance acts a few years ago, and people get it now, that it's kind of trancey, it's humorous as well, it's kind of tongue-in-cheek, it's exuberant, and it's trancey. And so it was kind of actually without a bit ahead of its time. And that was just me and John in the studio. Keith had gone, he wasn't around that night. We were in Mark Angelo Studios, and we just had some real fun. You know, we were hitting fire extinguishers and all that stuff, you know.
Do you think that it was or did you find working with John that he consciously did want to do something that was very different to the Pistols? Or was that just kind of how the songs emerged?
No, I think he just felt, because remember there was another guy, there were the four Johns, and it was John Gray. So there was John Beverly, or John Ritchie, as he was also known as, is Sid. Johnny Lydon, me, John Waldall, and John Gray. John Gray was an old school friend of John Lydon. And he was a very intelligent guy who actually wrote a couple of articles for NME, became a school teacher. And he was the big music fan. He liked Can and the Chieftains and, you know, had pretty good taste by now. Some of the stuff he would have liked, probably wouldn't, but you know, whatever. He was an intelligent guy you could have a conversation with, and I think he was in John's ear, okay, probably in a good way, saying, you know, as well, you know. And I think John was like, yeah, I've got to do something, you know, this is just not working out, this is not a good situation, we have to change this.
Yeah,
you know, we have to change this, and you know, I've got to do something else. And it was quite a brave decision. I think he wanted to go with people he trusted. I think he genuinely knew. I don't think he thought for a minute it was going to be as successful with me as it was. But I think he thought, yeah, we'll get him to play bass. He's my mate, I trust him, and he really likes bass, and he can basically play, so that'll do. And
yeah,
it'll be. And I don't think he realised how. I think it shocked him a lot, actually. I think how I took to it. I think it was like, well, you know. Keith was seen as the most interesting, probably the one of the best musician, as this maverick kind of figure, guitarist, that was actually sort of not just a free called fresh merchant, you know. And so that was quite an interesting basis to it all.
I think what it probably lacked from reading about it is any kind of formal business structure around the band.
No.
You didn't have any management.
Oh,
you didn't have an
unfair
agent.
Comment. No, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. There was no management. In a way, maybe at the beginning it was good because it was very exuberant. Maybe if there'd been a manager there, they would have said, oh, you can't work with a bass player like that, or he needs lessons or something. So that was, it was its strength at first. It was very exuberant, and you know, it was all sort of okay, and you know, but the business side of it, not only was there no management, so there wasn't any proper, it wasn't organised properly as far as I was concerned, and all that stuff. You know, the business got quite, for me, it wasn't straightforward, and got, you know, so it was great, exuberant, happy feeling in 78. The band formed about March of 1978. By November, there was an album, I think, recorded, and the first single was out, and I think the album came out either in the new year or so, probably actually at the end of 78.
Yeah.
I think the album, so it was all happened pretty quickly, which was good that it happened quickly, got the whole thing moving. As it went into 79, the lack of management really become apparent, you know, for me, yeah. You know, so you just wouldn't get situated. And too much money, so there's lots of money comes in that should really be spent properly on recordings, and it doesn't. It goes elsewhere on different things, you know, one way or the other. And, yeah, it was a nightmare. And I wanted to play, so I was very frustrated. And I was, so found a member of Public Image, and 78 through to, I think I left in May, June of 1980, and I think I did less than 30 shows.
Yeah.
30 shows in two, and that, it really killed me. You know, I just got, you go around to Gunter Grove where the base of the group was, where John lived. It was a, there was like a house, like two, basic house with an, another apartment kind of behind and below it. And that was where he lived, and Levine ended up living in the apartment there, the other apartment with Jeanette Lee, who had joined, which upset me as well when Jeanette joined, because it was like, well, what's Jeanette going to do? She's in the band. What's she going to do, videos,
okay,
you know, at the time? I mean, now it might be, actually would be a more valid thing, because you could have, you know. And actually, if I see Jeanette now, I get on with her, we laugh about it, it was fine. So, and she went on to have be very successful in the music business, yeah. So it was all good. But it was all a bit daft. And Jeanette would actually be the first to be there when we met. Oh, isn't it daft, you know, and you know.
So there was a lot of tension around, I think, as a result of that. Do you think that kind of...
Well, it was with me, because I turn up there and I never hung around, you know, that scene for too long, because I just got bored with it.
Yeah.
You know, because you're around, although, you know, you get a lot of hangers-on. And it's a kind of, what's it, the ennui, the French word, is it ennui, you know? I like the French kind of got this way with, you know, it's just, you know.
Do you think when you came to do the second album, Metal Box, that tension had some kind of bearing on the creativity? Because that album is still seen by many as one of the great albums of its era.
Yeah, well, the one time you still get it together was in the studio, so it all kind of, you had all that going on, it was really, and I think one thing it did to me, made you so frustrated. The one thing I had was access to the studio. This was fantastic, so I went and did solo things. One thing I could do was go in the studio, and Virgin would A-OK it, me going in the studio and ringing up a tab, which was, so I learnt my trade like that. You know, I was begun to making some crazy, again, all I wanted to do was make crazy records. I wasn't, I think, more conceptually about Peel than I would my own sort of thing. And I would just kind of do whatever took my fancy, and I just wanted to have fun in the studio and enjoy like a child with a paint set. And the great thing was, when we did get, I was so hungry to do something, do a gig, just do anything, that I was full of energy for the live things. And still, me and John were mates, so, you know, I remember he'd lost his mum. So, you know, you've got to be understanding. You can't, even a year young, you've got to be understanding why people might be a bit down, or for a good reason. So, you know, you look back now, there was dark aspects to it. And I have to say, I felt very frustrated and bored with a lot of it. It was this sort of, you know, when are we going to do something, you know?
On songs like Pop Tones, you were kind of really starting to reach out as a player as well.
Yeah, I started to really, you know, in the suite. I was really thinking about my playing a lot, you know, and it was starting to become a potent sort of time for me at that time, you know. And so lots of unhappiness around about. It was a very unhappy sort of vibe around it for me. Lots of stuff which I really didn't like. But the music, and of course, at the end of the day, if the music's okay, As a musician, it's all worth it. None of it matters as long as the music's good. So for all this stuff, everyone's got this story to tell, and yeah, I've got no axe to grind with any of it. I wouldn't change a thing, because I'm kind of happy exactly where I'm sitting now.
Yeah.
And talk. So it's all good. You know, it was all. Yeah, there were characters, and it's all absolutely. And everyone's a lot younger, of course, you know. I mean, my problem with it at times, I was 18 when Pilster was very young. And I really got quite frustrated, because I felt it was, the last thing you'd want to be when you're that age is being a teenage gang. Although I was the baby, I felt as I got near the end, it was they had the dynamics of a kind of teenage gang or something. That wasn't, and I just wanted to be a bit more grown up. So as we were touring America and still walking off stage, and you know, I wouldn't walk off stage. I was very angry, and that was like the last straw for me. I only stayed on to do America. I wanted to go to America. And then in America, there were John and Keith would walk off after 20 odd minutes. I'd be left with a drummer, and I really got annoyed with that. I just thought, it's not right. You know, it's got to show, and there's no need for it, because the audience there, I thought, was noticeably different to here. It was quite a hip James Blood, Ulmer, Ornette Coleman, quite left field. They were coming it from a completely different way. Whereas here, when we played like the Rainbow and stuff, you'd get a lot of angry punk guys with, those Mohicans with the big boots, and it was all. Whereas punk, when it started, was a kind of safe haven, like for maverick figures, girls, gays could come, and it would all be. It was a safe kind of place. It started to become a little bit thuggy. And, bottles being thrown and kind of a almost like the football mobs coming. And it just wasn't really like that in the States, generally speaking. I mean, the one time of that tour with Peel where there was problems was in California, funny enough. There was quite a ruckus in the crowd. But very much in that way where people outside of England and Britain would imitate years ago. Oh, let us be football hooligans, and and so it was like, oh, okay, man, this is a punk gig, we fight, you know. So there was a bit of that going on, but generally, people really, especially on the East Coast, they really got it. I was very frustrated that I felt we were doing something that I realised this is really good fun. This is kind of like real art in a good way, and we're acting like soppy teenagers walking off stage. What's all that? And I'm like, okay, I'm out of it. And I'm not even getting paid. I mean, it's awkward getting my money every week. So when I come back from America, the money was kept in a shoebox or two in a downstairs room. And I went, and I had the moral high ground, really. It's right, I took the shoebox of high denomination notes, and I went. And God bless it. You know what? It was great. It got me going. The whole thing's about my little. It's always been about me. But it's all been about my little trip. It's about your journey through life. And I thought probably I went off to America with that money and hired a Thunderbird and drove coast to coast, or so drove around and this, that, and the other. And I thought probably that's it. My time's up. And people said no. People said to me, don't be crazy, time's not up, you know, you'll be able to do something else. And within weeks, I was working with Holger Zucker and Jackie Libazay from Cannes. How good's that? And that was a success. So when I left Peel, it was actually a successful period. I formed Human Condition, started the prototype Invaders of the Heart, 83.
Was that Invaders of the Heart, was that kind of the first time that you put a band together on your own terms, if you like?
Human Condition kind of was edging that way first of all, but then the Invaders of the Heart, yeah, it was really my first ever proper band. And my first ever proper band, I was like a chef in the kitchen. I want strong grooves. I want to lean it a little bit away from dub. I was getting a bit tired of dub, because dub, just for that little time there, meant lowest common denominator. People smoking dope in basements, you know, in Streatham or something. You know, it was all a bit dubby, grungy kind of, whereas it had been King Tubby and Lee Perry and amazing music from the cosmos. The most amazing. When I went to those Jamaican blues dances in Hackney, you know, I'd creep in with Ronnie. It was like music from another cosmos. It was mind expanding. This deconstructed music that actually suggested space. Funny enough, when you suggest infinite space, if such a thing is possible, you suggest infinite silence. So it becomes a very beautiful, calm place, and it's all to do, obviously, with one's mind.
Yeah.
You know. So it's a beautiful thing. But it had become, just lowest common denominator, you know. And so I got tired with it. So I wanted different flavours. I wanted some Islamic scales. I wanted to, when you cook cumin, some turmeric, some thyme.
Bringing the different ingredients together.
You're bringing some different ingredients in, and you just got the mixer, and you're just mixing up some of those spices, and you're trying different flavours, you know, whilst hopefully being true to your own DNA. So there's a groove going on, you know. And so if you listen to something like Invaders of the Heart, the self-named track, it's really, it's really, really on the money, because you've got this do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. So it's a heavy dub, but it's not a classic dub line, but it kind of is. So it's a mode that's almost in an English country garden. In an English country garden. It's quite kind of tone vibe, but that the connection between Middle Eastern pentatonic stuff and English folk, if you like, so there's lots of interesting, very exciting time, heralded an exciting time, and I went off to New York. I was there when the loft scene was going and rap was just starting. So yet again, right place, right time, with Francois Kevorkian and The Edge. We did Snake Charmer album, so it was a great time, So when I left Peel, people often think, he left Peel, and then it was out of the business, drinking drugs. It was like, I hit the ground running for a few years. It was all really good, and it was only by about 86 that I was really, through my own, I can't blame anyone else but me, I put myself in that position, drinking too much, drugging too much,
How was, that mid-80s period was quite a difficult time for you, I think. As you say, drink was becoming a big part of your life.
It's funny with karma, sometimes karma comes to fruition and loads of things come together in a really great way and something really great happens and it all kind of moves on again. It's always a state of flux anyway, I suppose. But I think at times it's the reverse. It comes to fruition in bad ways. So I was really bad. The world for me was really bad. Thatcher, who I thought was very short-sighted, had come to power, and we were a few years into that. We'd had the Falklands War, blah, blah, blah. A lot of stuff I didn't like. The miners' dispute, the way that was handled, It's too easy to be an angry lefty and, yeah, it was wrong and, it should have been left as it was. Change needed to happen. You need to adapt, but it needs to be done a different way. Whole towns were just decimated in a way, So there was a lot of stuff going on. It was the first wave of lack of compassion, alert, this is dangerous territory and look where we are now, But also, even that it was heavy bass lines were out.
Yeah.
It was all kind of synth bass lines and the early days of sequence music. And it's a lot of it I would make. Some of it's good. It's an interesting time, the 80s, because of all technology coming in. Funny enough, with Redux, the box set, there's an 80s disc. And it's the disc I found the most interesting and challenging to put together. So it's an interesting time. But also some of the worst music there has ever been was created in the 80s.
When you look back at the stuff that you made in that decade, things like Psalms, which was, I think, 87, when you just kind of, you were taking those first steps after you gave up drinking to becoming sober.
Yeah.
Do you kind of look back on those as something that you're proud of, despite everything that was going on around the creation?
Well, I did Psalms, half in drink and drugs and half out of it, so it's an interesting little record, and that's actually a very interesting record when I look back at it. You can really hear a lot of what was to come over the next few years with the Invaders of the Heart Mark II, and actually some really, you look back, wow, there's a track on there, Enough with Bim Sherman, No Second Chances with who's the girl?
Julianne,
yeah. From what's the group,
Julianne? Everything But the Girl.
That's everything. No.
No, not Everything But the Girl, sorry. All About Eve.
All About Eve, yeah. And she really sung well on it. Really nice person, really sung well. And I heard that, it's like, well, that sounds like a hit. What a great track, Really, really good stuff. So there's a few very good tracks on there, and it's an interesting time. So I did that album. I had it finished by... I stopped drinking and drugging October the 23rd, 1986. I had that album finished by November, December 86. It came out, and in 87, I got a job on the Underground as a ticket collector, and then I crossed the divide and went on trains. I become train crew, and it came out, and I think I had a little break from music for about 3 months, if that. From January, I think I started the job on the Underground in the January 87 through to maybe March or something, and then Neville Murray come round. And Psalms had come out, didn't do anything. You know, I think it just sold a couple of thousand or whatever, you know, 3,000, whatever it was. Didn't, you know, it was a little, kind of did its thing. And then Neville Murray came around and said, you know, aren't you going to start a band again? And I'm like, what? Did you enjoy it? He said, yeah, I did. I loved it. You know, we should do it. Really?
He was in the first Invaders.
Yeah, Neville was in the first one. And he said, you should do it again. So I said, okay then. I said, you know, I need musicians we could do it with. He said, what are you looking for? I said, I'd like to make this even more kind of Middle Eastern. And he knew a guy called Justin Adams. And he said, he's a toff. Because me and Neville, because of that North London squat scene, we're very aware of resting toffs in the squat scene. But yet again, it's back to with now and I, you know. And he said, he went to Eton. No, bloody hell, you know, wow, really, you know. And, but he was one person who'd been brought up, his dad was a diplomat, and he'd spent some time in Jordan and stuff and heard the local music and liked it. So that was like, okay, ideal. And then wanted a kind of a textural acid house. Was really going at that time,
yeah.
And there was a guy's kind of acid house kind of called David Harrow, and got him in, and just, you know, you work with what musicians around and kind of make something interesting. I'm doing exactly the same now with Mark kind of three, really, or maybe it's Mark. It kind of mutated a bit in the 90s. It's argued this could be called Mark Four, actually, possibly, but whatever. I'm doing exactly the same now with the new group of players who actually technically are Mark. The Mark II and III generations kind of lacked musicianship, to be honest. It was all a bit smoke and mirrors and loops. A very successful period, to give it its due, and it had a certain charm. But the players I've worked with in the 70s and the 80s were better musicians, by and large, in the UK. In the 90s, the musicians I worked with in America were fantastic, you know, with Bill Laswell and all this crew. It was a joy to play with them, you know. And the present crop of players I got are very, very, and it really helps. It really helps.
And I guess the big sort of single, the big hit of Mark II was Visions of You,
yeah,
which had,
yeah,
Sinead O'Connor on vocals.
Yeah. Yeah.
What was that like to work with her and put that song together?
Well, there was a guy, John Reynolds, who was he was a guy I was friendly with, and I met him through Kevin Mooney, who was a friend of mine, who was in Adam and the Ants. And Kevin knew John, and I met John through Kevin. And John was married to Sinead, and John played a bit of drums. And I got friendly with John, and he'd come and play some drums with my band live. And it became evident Sinead liked what she'd come to a couple of shows and really liked it and said she'd like to sing a song. So we'd ended up where I'd had a deal. And we had all the tracks done, but we felt we didn't have a commercial single, a radio-friendly single. So we needed to get that together. I quite like that kind of pressure. And you've got to rein in the 6-minute groove things into some semblance of a, you know, beginning, middle, end, verse, chorus, middle, eight, yeah, and all that stuff, you know. And so got that together. And I knew I was going to write for her, which was great. So I was able to, I love visions of you, you know, thinking of Sinead's voice. And it started with a B line. Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I wrote it at Dello House with a Porter studio on the bed, which really is, again, probably contravenes health and safety to have a electrical device on bedding. But I laid back in bed with a Porter studio, put the bass line down, and then come up with the lyrics. It was written in 89, 90, some, just a few years. I'm well on the path of recovery, as they call it, you know, drinking drugs. And so it's all about, you know, addiction is, a lot of people would say, is a shame-based condition. And so I sing about, I'm not numb down anymore, no longer drenched in shame, you know. You talk about no longer feeling shameful about yourself and, you know, about getting on a path and, you know. And it's a devotional song, or in Sanskrit, Bhakti. It's just a song of devotion to your divine mother. I was brought up a Catholic, and I was still at the time very kind of swayed by a Catholic waves of thinking, if you like, you know, divine mother, the Holy Mary, that this was, you could go to mum, not to dad, you know. It's a, I know it sounds very Jewish, and I know secular atheists would at this point wanted to punch the screen, you know, so please, you know, whatever, it doesn't matter, you know, it's not a big deal. You know, that's how I was at that time, you know, you just, you could, you know, that you could approach the feminine thing would be a bit softer and more compassionate, you know,
yeah.
And you could find some kind of refuge in that was the, you know, was the idea. So it's a kind of Vedantic, you know, Vedantic as an Indian sort of a vibe to it. And it's got that Indian kind of overtone to it as well, you know, and it's mantra-like, you know, so it's like a mantra. I love visions of you. It's very much like Om Namah Shivaya, Om, like those Indian kind of mantras.
Yeah.
That's the vibe. So a very simple basis, you know. And then after that, it just needed a loop. I got John Reynolds to put a loop on and got Justin Adams. I had all the verse lyrics. And it's like, okay, let's get something. So it's quite, yeah, again, you asked me, so I'm going to bore you to tears. A hymn-like kind of Baptist almost, kind of, you know, do, 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 do. I'm not numbed out anymore, no longer feel that, no longer drenched in. It's like you can imagine some of an organ just playing the middle octave or so of an organ in a church or something. So it's all quite a religious, spiritual kind of vibe.
I think spirituality was definitely something that you were kind of finding in yourself around that early 90s period. You talk about it being a time when you became kind of very prolific as a musician, the music was pouring out of you. And that spiritual side was kind of in tandem with that as well?
Yeah, very much so. And I can't really, music's like it's kind of emanation. I find it impossible to put things in boxes for too long and keep them there anyway, because everything is interdependent, everything's linked. So it's the spiritual journey is the musical journey. The musical journey is the spiritual journey. And what is that journey? Over the years, it goes into a thing that's beyond the word called God. Or the word's divine mother. It goes beyond any concepts, any thoughts. It goes way beyond that, you know. Into a state beyond, you know, you know, I wouldn't even call it, I used to call it ultimate. I wouldn't even call it ultimate reality now. It's actually how things are. We just can't see it half the time or feel it half the time because we've always got a dirty windscreen. You know, we've always got a dirty windscreen. Our ears always need cleaning. You know, we're impure. In I don't mean in a Calvinist or Catholic we better whip ourselves or anything. We're just it's all a bit, our vision's a bit sullied, you know. Our perception is wrong. We think the wrong way, you know.
Yeah. And not too long after that.
That includes me, so I'm not a wise guy, by the way. You know, if I was, I'd be levitating. I'm not, you know, so I'm just, at least I kind of know it that I'm, you know.
Yeah.
I know I'm full of shit, you know, anyway, you know, yeah.
Not too long after that, you kind of, I guess, decided to take more of a hands-on control of the business side of how you worked. You started your own label, 30 Hertz.
That was a few years later. I went back to, I'd gone from Oval, it was a guy called Charlie Gillett over East West. And give Charlie's, you know, the times I really clashed with Charlie, really clashed with him. At times I thought, oh, God, why do I have to have a, why can't I just be, you know, why do I have to get kind of shit at me and other artists don't get in a way? I felt, you know, because there was tapes were edited and that, and I felt wasn't the right thing. It wasn't right, shouldn't have been done. Actually, really shouldn't have been done, you know. And that's after success, after visions. It's after, and you think, wait a minute, you know, just, look what you've got. Surely you want to leave me alone now,
yeah.
and just give me a little bit of space. Surely I've earned that. And that, so it didn't really happen. So we left. We were able to leave and went to Ireland. I was back home. And I always felt back home at Ireland. I first went to Ireland with the invasion of the whole Gazookai thing with Jackie Libazay, the Full Circle.
Yeah.
In fact, How Much Are They EP? And that was in 1980. So. And I'd been, and then Snake Charmer was on Ireland. I did Neon Moon, which is another hidden little kind of obscure record of mine, which is features on Redux as well, which is Beast Inside of Me, which is about man's travails with alcohol and the bottle, you know. I felt I was going back home. And I always, as record company tycoon Coons went, I quite liked Chris Blackwell. I thought he was a good guy. And, you know, as I say, as they go, you know, he was a good guy, and I felt back home, and that did take me to God, which was a big, it's like a big double album, really. It was great. And then they indulged me, let me go and work with Pharoah Sanders. We did Heaven and Earth, which I think is a cracking album. And I bet you now, actually, has probably over the years has sold really pretty well. And, you know, they probably made money from. So it's all good. The bottom line's covered. But I said to them, they were really prepared to back me. I think they were quite keen for me to, at that point, the Invaders and Heart, ditch a lot of the band and people around me, to be quite honest, and to go off. And they were quite prepared and happy to fund me as an individual artist with producers or whatever. But I, unfortunately, was just coming out with... I did a record with Eno. I produced Eno, which was a successful record. It could not be without Brian Eno's name on it, you know. But I was still the only dude ever to have produced him. But unfortunately for Ireland at the time, I was doing Requiem Masses. I did a William Blake album. Did all sorts of, I was coming out of all kinds of stuff. And when I went in to see them, they were very nice, but they went kind of glazed-eyed. When I'm working on a Requiem Mass, it was what they didn't want to hear. Where they want to hear that, yeah, I'm back in the commercial saddle and I'm ready. And I'm like, oh, actually, I've done this Requiem Mass. And I said, really what I want to do is form a left field label. I'm a terrible salesman. And I wondered if you'd fund it. And they just both went, no. But we'll let you go, and we'll give you your database, which is actually very sweet and very nice. So that was all good, and I went off, and immediately lost my publishing deal, lucrative publishing deal, which, you know, yet again I knew would probably, it didn't bother me, and I formed 30 Hertz Records as a refuge. It was a refuge away from the corporate business, because the record business at that point had got involved with the City of London. Ireland, it'd been a great little period around about the time of Take Me to God, because they'd been purchased by Polygram. But the corporate thing hadn't quite grabbed them. They had the best of both worlds. They had the heavy hitting qualities of a big corporate company, but they still had the control of an independent. But that started to go, you see. That was part of the problem, I felt. And I could feel the business changing, and these independent spirited kind of guys that I'd met along the way, you know, the Charlie Gillets of this world, God bless Charlie, you know, people like that, who, as I say, whatever fault you might, they'd seen something. There was an enthusiasm. They were enthusiasts.
Yeah.
They were enthusiasts. And they liked the business. They liked doing business, but they liked the music, and they liked the scene. They enjoyed it. But the corporate thing's a bit dead-eyed, you know. And I've got to form a refuge. I've got to protect myself and my music. And I just knew I had a ton of music just pouring out of me, and I had to document it and protect it. And that's what it was about, you know.
And I guess that doing it that way has kind of given you a lot of musical freedom that you wouldn't have had in that corporate structure. I mean, you've made lots of different types of records in the 30
years. Within reason,
years.
I could sit there and, you know, go to myself in my mind and say, I'd like to make a record of Laotian music. It's called, the genre is called Molem. Is that possible? Yes, I think so. How much will you need? I think I'll need about £10,000 for this one. I'd like you to bring it in for eight. Okay. So, you know, that's kind of how it kind of was. And so I just kept, I was able to do Chinese music, Japanese music with, you know, and I'm still doing it. I mean, we're still doing music, you know. And so it was a great, the Japanese thing was great fun, the Chinese. And I've made some real left field groove albums. I've done attic albums, a bit like the bedroom album I did years ago. I've gone back and done it with me engineering, and it's all lo-fi and ham-fisted technically, but it's got a vibe, and yeah. I know that, and I'm clever enough to leave that. And then when I'm going to go and do something at a very high spec, I know exactly how to make that work with, you know, Rolls-Royce kind of, you know, like, and I drive an XJ. I like Jaguars, you know, and it just, they listen to that engine, you know, that purring, the class of a expensive record. I still love that. But I also still like an old Citroen car. I still like fresh fish and vegetables on a beach that's just fried. It's just, you know.
Yeah, you can visit both ends of the scale.
You can go to it all, yeah.
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 So, Redux, as we said at the beginning, 6-CD set, looking back across your career. Why did it feel like now was sort of the right time to do a project like that?
Circumstance, karma decides. It's never been part of a master plan. as I was saying to you outside, it just feels like really good timing. Everything seems to have kind of come together at a point now where, you know, I actually feel it's documenting itself. This is just feels the right, exactly the right time just to have a retrospective. It's incredible because I did an anthology that did very well in, I think, about 2003. And I remember that really felt like, well, this is it. Won't do another one of these, I suppose. And there's some hard choices here. I didn't expect this, you know. And I'm sure this will be, you kind of think, this probably surely has to be the, you know, six CD. Surely that's got to be the last anthology of sorts, collections of sorts. But it feels really like the right time to do it now.
And yeah. Often when people do something like this, it's sort of a slowing down in the career or towards the end, but I'm sure that's not going to be the case with you.
No, I mean, that's the thing. What happened, it's inspired me. I listened to disc one, which is the more pop commercial side of things. There's six discs, there's pop, 80s, world beat, jazz, and there's covers. The covers album's actually been the greatest fun.
Which is new material that you've recorded for the box.
Yeah, and it's some of my favourite covering favourite film tunes from the past and TV tunes even, you know. So you've got like the Good, the Bad and the Ugly theme, Midnight Cowboy. I love John Barry, you know. Liquidator is quite a disparate. The theme tune to the Persuaders is on there, which is a beautiful tune. I think probably John Barry again, actually. He's a fantastic writer. But with the pop disc, I'm thinking, God, you know, I really want to do something pop. So Jamie Crossley, who's a guy I work, who's a producer, multi-instrumentalist, I said to Jamie, we were talking about music, and we've both got a bit of a penchant for West Coast psychedelic kind of music. Jamie especially, and I said, I want to do a pop thing that's got that kind of sensibility. I really don't want to do something. And so, you know, so there's, I've got a ton of new tracks, and this is some of them going on to read, but I've actually got two or three albums coming up, I'm afraid. So there's still, maybe there will be another anthology.
You never know.
But it feels like, because for me personally, I just feel it's kind of the end of one stage, and I feel like I'm going into a new stage. One of the things, when I started 30 Hertz, I never wanted to be bothering with the running of a business. I have to say it weighs you down a bit. I want to be creative. So one of the things I want to do is relinquish that stuff in the forthcoming years. I want to do a PhD just for fun. I did a BA in the middle of the most successful time in the 90s. I want to do a BA. It annoyed people, actually, because they said, well, why are you doing that? And everyone thinks you're doing it. I want to do it for fun. So I went to Birkbeck and did a BA, Humanities, Philosophy, some of a bit dry, like predicate logic and stuff, but I just wanted it for fun, and I want to go and do a PhD. I'm going to be doing some more academic stuff. I'm really tired of brown boxes, because if you start a label, you might think you won't have to see the brown boxes. You're actually sure you won't have to see the brown boxes. Other people will deal with the brown boxes. You won't have a hall for the brown boxes.
CDs coming and going.
You end up with a house. It's like Triffids. You end up with brown boxes. You get a big house because you need the space, because you need to keep some brown boxes and the mail order and all that stuff. And actually, you know what? My wife, she helped me out in 98. I've got a guy in to run it, and it was like, oh my God, it's like the days of when footballers used to take pubs over, and they used to think it was easy. They could take the pub on, but then go and play golf. And they quickly would learn, if they were going to stay in the pub game, that they actually couldn't go and play. They had to be in the pub and keep an eye on things. And you have to run it yourself. So it was like, oh, right, I can't just be one of those. I've got to really, really run this myself and do all the budgets and do all the hard work myself. And that's how it was, you know.
So
I want to get away from that as well, you know.
A lot of my research for this was based around reading your book, Memoirs of a Geezer. It's an excellent book. Go out and buy it if you haven't already. There's a quote in there that says, I'm not interested in selling to the masses. I make music for freaks because I am one.
Mm.
When you look back across your career to date, do you take a lot of pride in what you've achieved, but particularly in the way that you've done it?
Yeah, I do. But I think you have to be careful, because I think a big danger for blokes my age of turning a few records out is you get pompous. Simple as that. You get a bit pompous, a bit self-important. And at the end of the day, really, what's happened? It's been a continuous coming together of causes and effects. And you've had an idea or two, but you better be careful that you don't set yourself up as the architect of the universe, because I'm not, you know.
But you've been incredibly...
I am a freak.
You've been incredibly tenacious. You know, there's been a lot of times when you've said, I think this might be the end of it for me in music.
Every
you've gone
year,
off and done other jobs.
Every year, I think this could be the last year. Every year, you just think you might be out of fact. And that's actually not a bad feeling. Every year, you know, it could be the end. But when I said freaks, I meant kind of musical freak. I am a freak anyway. But I'm a musical freak, you know. I'm a music freak. I love music. And my music was always for other people that was, you know, in a way, it's like a healthy counterpart to drug take. Because, yeah, chop this out. This is really good stuff, man. Oh, you know, this is, I'm like, listen to check this music out. And I know, oh, yeah, give me the music. So it's kind of a buzz in a good way. It's transcendental. I'm an altered states guy. I'm coming from the altered states music guy, not mutually exclusive from pop music, you know, but I'm an altered states guy, really, you know, that's the music alters one state. It clears, hopefully, those veils and illusions, you know, that I was talking about sort of earlier. So, you know, and then, funny enough, when you do that, you're more likely to have big success than when you really try for big success and you try and get formulaic, whichever, and that's what's helped kill the record business creatively. I mean, there's very little new stuff. You know, the best creativity now is in television, which is weird because television was the squarest. People that worked in television were ashamed of working in television. They wanted to be in movies. But now television, HBO, is the most exciting area to be in, you know. And you've got, they're the new novels because these new TV series are written like novels. They're incredible. And yet you've got cinematic qualities to them as well, you know, and their social commentary and a great use of music, you know. So there's always good music out there, but, you know, it's...
Well, we hope you still continue to bring excitement to music and wish you the best with Redux and forthcoming musical career.
Lovely. Thanks
very much.
Thank you.
And join us again soon for more Cherry Red TV.